Hey, here in this picture, we see a single sugar on the left-hand side, which is a monosaccharide because there's only one. It does happen to be the representation, the organic representation of glucose. And we'll talk later on about the shorthand form that they're showing here. Basically, every corner that we see a line, notice that there would be four bonds running to every corner except where we have the oxygen specified. And oxygen, we know, can only have two bonds. Therefore, you see two bonds coming off the O in the molecule. But every other corner, we have four bonds. So what we understand about that is that there's actually a carbon in every corner. And then there's going to be oxygens and hydrogens attached to the other places. So, but again, looking at a single ring structure, we know it is a monosaccharide because it's one sugar. Now, looking at B in the picture, we see it says double sugar. So that means there are two sugar chains hooked up, and that would be a disaccharide. Here we see some more carbohydrates. In this case, we see a polysaccharide because we have many glucose molecules hooked up together. In this case, it happens to be a starch. And this is the way that a lot of plants store sugar. And so these are the things that we tend to get a lot of calories from because there's a lot of sugar molecules inside of them. Here we see an actual glucose molecule. So we actually use a shorthand form. If you'll notice the picture up in the right-hand corner with the ring structure, what we see is that, notice there's a carbon in every corner that has four bonds, either to a hydroxide, which is OH, or to a hydrogen, or to other carbons. The exception to that is in the right-hand corner of the ring structure, we see oxygen, which of course can only make two bonds. So anywhere we see an oxygen, it's only going to be bonded twice. And that's because of the octet rule we had talked about earlier, where oxygen has eight protons, therefore eight electrons, six in the outer valence shell, therefore it can only make two bonds. Whereas carbon, which had an atomic number of six, had four electrons in its outer shell, therefore it could make four more bonds to fulfill the octet rule. So everywhere we see a carbon, we should be able to count four bonds. Hydrogen, of course, can only make one bond, so everywhere we see a hydrogen, it will only have one bond attached to it. So since this is the only way that it can be, since this is understood, then we can take a shorthand form, and we don't necessarily have to show all of the carbons or hydrogens or oxygens. We can just show the basic ring structure, even though they will usually still include the oxygen in the corner, since that way it won't be confused for a carbon. Here we see two types of basic chemical equations that are occurring. One, we're actually doing a synthesis reaction. The other, we're doing a degradation reaction. Now, the synthesis reaction is actually called a dehydration synthesis because we're taking two molecules, both of them actually being monosaccharides. They even both have the same chemical formula, C6H12O6, but the arrangement of the atoms is different in each of these different molecules. Glucose has this classic arrangement that we will see mostly, but then you can see the molecule to the right of it, fructose, still has C6H12O6, but they are bonded differently on the molecule. But if we want to actually take these two monosaccharides and make a disaccharide called sucrose, which again is common table sugar, then what we're going to have to do is we're going to have to make room for the bondings to occur by dehydrating it or removing water from it. So what we're going to have to do that, if you look on the right-hand side of the glucose molecule, notice the hydroxide group, the OH, is in red, whereas on the left side of the fructose molecule, we need to combine the hydroxide with the hydrogen that is actually on the fructose. So when we combine those and remove water from it, then we've opened up the bonding. Now the carbon from each one can bond to the oxygen that's still left on the fructose molecule. So when we bind these, then we come up with our disaccharide, which you see on the right side of the equation, called sucrose. Again, dehydration synthesis, we are removing water so we can join the molecules. Okay, and of course, if we're going to build a polysaccharide, we would keep doing the same thing. We would keep dehydrating it, keep removing water and combining the molecules so that they still fulfill the octet rule within the whole molecule. Now, on the bottom part, we're seeing that we're going to have, whereas we had a synthesis equation above where we're putting something together, on the bottom, what do we do to take it apart? How do we degrade it? Well, what we have to do to take it apart is we actually have to add water to it. And what we have to do is split the water or hydrolyze it, which we get the term hydrolysis. Lysis means splitting, hydro means water. So if I want to break up the molecule, I've got to break up water so I have something to replace where I broke the bonds so I can get my separate molecules. So when we eat table sugar, such as sucrose, then there's actually energy being involved in this and even enzymes involved in this. We'll talk about those later. But what we're going to have to do is split the water, add the hydroxide group and the hydrogen to the molecule where we split it so that we fulfill the octet rule again, but now we get two separate molecules, both a glucose and a fructose. So again, when we eat table sugar, sucrose itself is too big to be used by our cells. So we have to split it into individual monosaccharides so our cells can actually get benefit from it. And again, this is called a hydrolysis. Now we're going to see the same types of reactions in all of the organic molecules if we're either putting them together through dehydration synthesis or breaking them down through hydrolysis synthesis. Hydrolysis. Here we see an example of a common polysaccharide that we store in our body. This is called glycogen, which we store both in our liver and in our muscles. And of course, this is very similar to the way plants store starch. We eat the starch that the plants store, but we store our sugar that we don't use in our liver and in our muscles as this product called glycogen. Notice there are many side chains in this structure, and that's one way we can tell the difference just by looking at a picture between whether it's glycogen or starch. Glycogen has many more side chains of glucose molecules. Here we see another couple of representatives of polysaccharides, and basically these are the way that plants store the glucose as either starch or cellulose. Of course, we know there are many different types of starches and different types of cellulose, but here's what they have in common. Notice that starch basically has side chains of where it's storing its glucose molecules, not as many as the glycogen, but there are side chains. And then look at the cellulose, which we know things like the foods that we would typically think of as maybe salad-type foods would be cellulose-structured foods, whereas starch would be all those foods that we really like but that actually tend to give us more calories. Now, the reason that we get more calories out of the starchy foods than the cellulose, because they're both just glucose molecules hooked together. But if you'll notice the cellulose, notice that the way the bonds are, the bonds kind of alternate back and forth to the ring structures of the glucose. Whereas in the starch, all the glucose molecules are basically oriented in the same direction. This is important because we have enzymes that help us break down the starch, so we can pretty much break down each of the glucose molecules within the starch. But the cellulose, because it's structured chemically different, we don't have the enzymes to efficiently break that down. Now, a horse or a cow or certain animals that graze, the reason why they can get so much energy out of grass, which is a cellulose-based structure, is because they actually have the enzymes that are able to chemically break down this alternating arrangement of glucose molecules. Our next group of organic molecules we want to kind of become familiar with are our lipids, which are basically our fats, oils, and waxes that are in the body. And since they're organic, they also contain carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen, but not in the same ratio that we see them in our carbohydrates. In our carbohydrates, there's always a 1:2:1 ratio. So for every carbon, there's two hydrogens and the same number of oxygens. But in lipids or fats, we don't see that same ratio. As a matter of fact, we see much less oxygens. We never see a 1:1 ratio of oxygens to carbons like we do in carbohydrates. Now, one thing about lipids is they are not polar molecules. So therefore, we've heard the saying, oil and water don't mix. Therefore, we'll say that fats or oils are insoluble. They want to separate from water. They don't want to dissolve in it or or be attracted to it. Okay, we have different types of lipids in the body. The one we're going to probably talk about the most and probably the most common is our triglycerides, which are termed neutral fats. And that's what we actually find in our adipose cells or our fat cells or fat tissues. And they're called triglycerides for a reason. They actually have three fatty acids connected to a glycerol. Therefore, we have tri, referring to the three fatty acids and the glycerol being what they are attached to. And of course, one of the main jobs, especially of these stored fats, is they are a stored energy source. So carbohydrates are a quick energy source. We usually burn those, use those first, but we can store energy in the form of fat. These are also used to cushion things and protect things and to insulate things, but the main job is to store energy. Even though we can't really use the energy as a triglyceride, what we can do is we can break off the fatty acids and we can utilize the fatty acid portion of the triglyceride very similar to the way we utilize the glucose. Besides the neutral fats, so we call triglycerides, another real important job and important type of lipid is the phospholipid. It forms the majority of our cell membrane. These individual molecules combine together, make up the majority of the molecules within the cell membrane. And then finally, another super important lipid are the steroid lipids that basically are cholesterol-based lipids, including cholesterol itself, including hormones such as estrogen and testosterone, and even vitamin D and bile, which is an emulsifier found that's produced by our liver and stored in our gallbladder. Here we see some actual chemical representations of some of those lipids. On the top, we actually see a triglyceride, and we see that the triglyceride is made out of three fatty acids connected to a glycerol. And of course, when we put these together, we put them together by dehydrating it. Again, a dehydration synthesis. And notice that we pull the water out of it, we dehydrate it, which opens up the bonding between the three fatty acids and the glycerol. So we see our neutral fat, or three fatty acids, and a glycerol. Now, we actually store the neutral fat, the triglyceride, as adipose. If we actually want to use it for energy, we have to do the reverse reaction. We actually have to add the water back, splitting the water, and therefore splitting the molecule, because what we would do, again, is we would actually use the fatty acid portion of this as an energy source. Now, below, the molecule we see below is actually a phospholipid molecule, which if you look at the small little representation on the right-hand side, notice it has a polar head, meaning it's charged. And if you look at the look in the purple section, notice that within the atoms in that phosphorus head, notice that we have some charges on there. So that means that it's going to be attracted to water, because we know water is also polar. But then notice we have the glycerol backbone, same type backbone we actually had in the triglyceride, but we have two fatty acids attached instead of three fatty acids, and these form the nonpolar tail, and then they're not attracted to water. This is going to be super important, because the phosphorus head, which is polar, will always point towards water, but the tails that are on the opposite side that are nonpolar, they'll always try to go to the opposite direction of wherever the water is. Therefore, we find these in what we call phospholipid bilayers, where the heads point towards the water outside of the cell and the water inside the cell, but the tails point inwards, and they actually form a protective waterproof barrier. Again, we see up top, on the top left-hand side, both in the picture and the chemical diagram, we do see the phospholipid, again, with the phosphate head that is charged. We see the glycerol that's also attached to the fatty acid tails. The fatty acid tails are hydrophobic, meaning they don't like water. The head is hydrophilic, meaning it does like water. Now, we also have what we call glycolipids, which also have glycerol units with fatty acids attached to them. But instead of a phosphate head, they would actually have a carbohydrate-based head. And, of course, these glycolipids are going to be the body's way that